Hello, we are Liz and Jamie.
And we live on a boat with a cat.
In the last episode, a leaking fuel hose proved to be an awkward job to fix. Jamie answered a medical emergency call. And we finally left the marina. We are just outside the marina. Marina's there. Came out today, hurrah! And we're staying here overnight. Sunset over there. Very happy Millie over there. And a relaxed, so relaxed, gonna fall asleep, Elizabeth, right here.
How does it feel?
Oh, just can't explain how great it is to be out of the marina, on the water, on your boat. Only boaties really understand. But it's great, it's that moment that you feel free, feel relaxed, part of nature. One of our patrons asked us what we do about lighting the boat at night, so it seems a good opportunity now as the sun's going down for you to let everyone know.
Okay, so we have the usual anchor light which sits at the top of the mast. This is an LED light and it draws very little. We've always had an LED anchor light and it's been great. The problem is that the coal regs, the collision regulations, are not often adhered to in this part of the world, and quite often the traffic you get through here will be long tails and low fishing boats. So fishermen are generally looking out for lights at sort of eye height, and they don't look up. So in this part of the world, a lot of yachts now use these things. Okay, so these are light sensitive. There we go, you can just see it. I have to cover it up. They're light sensitive and they just take 2D batteries, and they're completely waterproof. And so we suspend one on the bow just above head height. I tend to point them downward so they light up the deck, and one on the stern again just at head height. They're both white, so we've got the white anchor light and then these two flashing white lights. And then on top of that we've got a mizzen floodlight, which was a cheap Chinese light we got for about $10, and again that only draws 0.1 or 0.2 amps, and that lights up the whole cockpit, and obviously it lights on the bimini so it diffuses across the cockpit. So with those four lights, Esper's pretty well lit up. I'm not going to say that that's going to prevent people from bumping into her, because you just don't know. But and the other thing as well, I have to mention this, was a little present from Gia and Julie from PSS. It was a leaving present, and it's a little solar powered light. It's actually also a radio, and you can plug in your MP3 player into it as well, so it's got a little speaker in it. But because it's solar powered, we leave this out during the day to charge up, and then at night time it's got different settings, and again it's just an extra light that we throw on the boat. So we're pretty well lit up. That's what we do in this part of the world.
The water rocked Esper gently through the night, giving us the best sleep in weeks. And with all those lights on, the fishing boats managed to avoid hitting us.
The next morning we were keen to head off to northern Phangnga Bay, where the limestone karsts there form some of the most iconic views of Thailand.
Right, what's happening then?
Okay, if you get ready with the anchor.
We were going along, we were doing about 3.5-4 knots in about 11 to 12 knots of wind, and then the wind died right down to 5 knots and we were down to 2.4 knots. So we put the headsail right out, and then the wind of course suddenly decided to go up to 12 knots. So we sped along and heeled over a little bit, but we're okay, back on an even keel now, as they say.
So we should explain, we're trying to avoid... Aren't we trying to avoid hammering it along and heeling over too much?
Yeah, we are, because we haven't, to be honest, really stowed completely. We've got pretty much everything as it should be, but if we heel over far, you know, way over, then a few things are going to fall off, which won't be great.
So we're actually trying to avoid heeling over.
Correct.
Putting out too much sail.
Yeah. But we also want to sail, and we want to get a little bit of speed.
And we've got the tide against us as well.
We have, yeah, and we've got a sort of, I don't know, what would you call this reach? It's not close haul, it's not...
Well, it's almost a beam reach.
It's almost a beam reach, really, yeah.
Phangnga Bay is like a mini version of the UNESCO World Heritage Site of Halong Bay in Vietnam. Made from soft sedimentary limestone, the islands are vulnerable to erosion from the sea, rain, and increasingly heavy vegetation. Hongs, literally translated as rooms, form within and under them, inviting travellers to explore the sinkholes, caves, and chimneys which riddle these spectacular karst islands. Our destination was Koh Phanak, a long thin island with its four distinctive peaks jutting high into the blue sky. Like most of the islands in this region, it is uninhabited. But the untouched subtropical rainforest is home to all kinds of species. On this trip, we were looking forward to navigating through a bat cave.
Okay, so we are now at Koh Phanak. It's spelled P-H-A-N-A-K, I think. And apparently there's a bat cave, which is... We think it could be that one there. And you can go through the back cave and you can get to a hong, which is Thai for room, we learned. And it's a room inside the island. But you can only get through at certain times of the tide. And at the moment we're high water, so we probably can't get through. You only have 1 hour to get in there. And if you don't get back in time, you're then stuck in there for the next 6 hours until the tide turns. But we're just going to go and have a little recce this afternoon. We suspect it will probably get a bit busy tomorrow with tourists, so we're going to have a look now, see what we can find, and then maybe come back tomorrow and actually go inside.
Would you like to take a trip to a land you've never been to before? Just leave it all behind. Take a trip. Take a long ride on the train. Would you like to take a trip to a land you've never been to before?
Are you scared?
I'm finding it a bit freaky. It looks like an angel with its wings down and its head bent down. That's absolutely bizarre.
The undercuts and overhangs found at sea level along the shore of Koh Phangnga are typical of the karst topography of the area.
Fall asleep. Dream about how we're staring out these windows. Living in dreams. Get about where we came from. Destination unknown.
Murphy's law of anchoring states that if you reach the anchorage first, everyone else will assume you're in the best spot and anchor right next to you. They didn't stay for long, and while the sun made another spectacular disappearance, we planned tomorrow's trip through the cave to the heart of the island. We woke up early to catch the midway rising tide. This would give us just enough time to get into the middle of the island and back before the cave flooded. We strapped cameras to ourselves in the dinghy and torches on our heads. We were the only ones in the anchorage, but we needed to hurry if we were to manage the trip before the first tourist boat arrived. Northern Phangnga is a marine park and the area has a delicate ecosystem, so visitors are asked not to use outboard motors or make loud noises inside the caves and hongs, which might disturb the wildlife. We continued to drift and paddle through the pitch-black cave. Then round another snaking bend, we saw the first sliver of daylight.
Where are we, Liz?
We're in the middle of the island. We're in a hong. This is a real hong. And it looks prehistoric, doesn't it? And we just came in through that little cave there. There's another one over there.
Yeah, except it's a rising tide, yeah. And we had to stoop to get through there, which basically means I think we have just a few minutes before we can get back out through there.
But isn't it beautiful?
But we had to move soon, otherwise all that nature would have us until the next tide before we could head back to Esper. Like most trips, it seemed much quicker going back. It was a close-run thing, but we managed to make it out just as the crowds arrived. Before upping the anchor for our next haven, we had a quick look at the small tidal beach, which still had some sand on it, as well as a few visitors. I think this is our next anchorage, which is called Koh Yai, which is the big sister island to the one we're going to go to tomorrow, which is
Koh Hong. There.
Supposed to be a very pretty spot. Unfortunately, they do charge. So, and it's not cheap either. It's according to the pilot book published 2 years ago, it is 500 baht a person, which is a tenner, £10 sterling, and also for the boat, isn't it?
Yeah, another 200 for the boat, but I'm not quite sure what's going to happen here. We were supposed to be charged when we were in Koh Rock, but it was out of season, so they didn't charge us.
We've anchored, you can't tell from the camera, but quite a way out from the rock, from the island here, because we have a tiny little breeze, which is an easterly, as we're pointing now, that's the east. So I thought we'd hang around just outside the island here to just get a little bit of a breeze. Probably quite unorthodox as far as the day trip for boats are concerned. Of course, they're always tied up right next to the islands. And the pilot book only really identifies anchorages of note by the islands themselves. What it does say, however, is that you can pretty much anchor anywhere, because out there, the maximum depth I've seen in the last 2 days is about 8 or 9 meters. So that is one great big anchorage.
Smell the cold breeze blowing through this world that used to taste of. Doing fine, just feeling blue.
It is, and I was trying to think of an adjective to describe this, and I ended up using the one adjective that I absolutely detest and hate. It's a personal pet hate of mine, that one word. What is it?
Awesome.
Awesome.
To be fair to the word awesome, by the way.
Yes.
It's a good word.
It is a good, yes.
It's just overused,
isn't it?
It's a bit like brilliant or fantastic, you know.
Yeah, I mean, come on, like, I use words like cool or wicked, which are completely, you know, it's bastardization of the English language. But no, the word awesome, it's just the way people use it on Facebook to describe blurry photographs of what they've had for lunch. But it's when you come to somewhere like this, which truly is awe-inspiring, that you realise this is the definition of awesome. This is nature at its most awesomeness.
And what is it about it that for you makes it awesome?
Yeah, it's well, you've got the tall jutting out sheer rock islands,
yeah,
dotted all around.
Yeah.
You've got the mainland mountains behind, which are kind of like the backdrop. What else have we got? I mean, it's lovely shallow water with good holding, so you can anchor anywhere. You can literally anchor anywhere around here. And it's just the fact that it's not too busy as well, so you wake up in the morning, it's quiet. Just the sound of the birds in among the trees on the sheer rock faces. Yeah, it's just, I don't know, it's just kind of, this is nature at its most awesome.
And it's really lovely and peaceful too, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, after you cooked that lovely meal last night, we laid back for as long as our weary backs would allow us and looked up at the stars, and it reminded me of when we first started out in Turkey. And in fact, a lot of this area does remind us of Turkey, apart from the water clarity. It's not so good here, but it's got that feeling of that rugged nature that's completely unspoilt, and it's one great big playground for us.
Yeah.
On the shoreline after sunset, watching seabirds soar, feet in the sand with my head in my hands, this luxury washing us over.
October and November is the transitional period when the southwest monsoon has finished and the northeast is yet to start. It can bring turbulent and unpredictable weather.
How long before it it's gone.
What's going on?
The heavens just opened, and this little port light, which is normally fine in a bit of rain, has decided to have a waterfall come off the deck straight into the top shaft. There was that much water in. So I think I've ruined a few books, but we'll see. The bottom shelf's okay, I just thought I'd take everything out. Use this as an opportunity to clear up.
We were outside having a shower, weren't we?
We were having a shower.
It has been raining, it's a squall. And yes, we are nice and clean. However, so is the inside of the boat.
But squalls don't last long out here, and pretty soon the rain cleared and it was back to a beautiful Thailand day. In the next video, we take you to one of the most beautiful hongs in Phangnga Bay. We discover an isolated beach used only by local fishermen. And we take the dinghy through some of nature's most spectacular creations.
Follow the boat.
Hi, follow the boat.
Follow the boat.
Follow the boat.
If you missed it, you can catch our previous episode here. If you're interested in the technical side of boat maintenance, then check out our complete boat refit playlist here. If you're interested in supporting our videos, find out more about our Patreon campaign here. We'd love to welcome you on board.